Welcome to Stories from the NNI. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Today, it's my pleasure to welcome Nicole Steinmetz, Professor of Nanoengineering and the Director of the Center for Nano-Immunoengineering at the University of California, San Diego. Nicole, thank you so much for joining us today. To get things started, could you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you first got involved in nanotechnology?
I'm actually a molecular biologist by training. Then I found myself later on in my career entering the field of nanotechnology. During my undergraduate research, which I did in Germany, I started my research by studying plant viruses in plants. So my master's thesis or diploma thesis focused on making fluorescently tagged plant viruses to understand how they traffic through a plant. So I started my work in applied plant virology. From there, I moved to the UK, where I did my PhD research at the John Innes Center. So during this time, during my PhD research, I started working at the interface of inorganic chemistry and virology. So at this time, I no longer considered viruses as infectious agents and studied how they propagate in plants, but rather I used them as a materials scaffold. And the goal was to combine inorganic chemistry with virology to make biohybrid nanomaterials. The long-term vision was to use such materials in biosensors and battery electrodes and other devices. And I was really fascinated with the concept of engineering biology, engineering viruses, as a way to create hybrid nanomaterials. And from there, I moved on to do a postdoc at the Scripps Research Institute here in San Diego. During that time, I started using viruses as imaging contrast agents, as well as thinking about them as a potential way to deliver drugs. And today, I'm a professor in nanoengineering.
I understand one of the other areas that you've explored is immunotherapy. Could you explain a little bit about what that is and what your approach is there?
Yes, absolutely. So the immunotherapy and one particular area we are focused on, cancer immunotherapy, is a very exciting thrust in my lab. It's probably the most translational research thrust that we're currently developing. So with the immunotherapy, what we've done is we took a plant virus. We look at these materials really just as nanoparticles. And we use this for the treatment of cancer. And we have done this in mice, but more importantly, we've also treated dogs with cancer. So these are somebody's pet. We've treated dogs with melanoma as well as sarcoma, and we've done it successfully. So it's a very exciting field. Our body's own immune system has a way of recognizing cancer cells and fighting cancer cells. However, as a tumor progresses and becomes very aggressive, a tumor has a way of shutting down this natural function of the immune system. And that can happen on many different levels. Tumors can prevent immune cells from entering into a tumor. On the other hand, tumor cells can manipulate immune cells that generally are set out to fight tumor cells in a way that they become pro-tumor. So they turn a tumor-fighting cell into a pro-tumor cell. And this is what we call an immune suppressive state. Immune cells no longer come in, and the ones that come in are pro-tumor rather than anti-tumor. Now, the plant virus, even though it's a plant virus that is non-infectious towards humans, it's still being recognized by the immune system as foreign. So it has all the bells and whistles that would alarm the immune system, just like a mammalian pathogen has. So we take these plant viruses and we inject them directly into an identified tumor. And what happens is this plant virus now has danger signals. And immune cells that are within the tumor that at the present state are quite immune suppressed, they become alerted because they feel these danger signals from the plant virus. So the immune suppressed state turns over into an immune activated state. These immune cells will communicate to other immune cells. And within a few hours, this sort of cold tumor turns into a hot tumor. These immune cells look for an infection, but there is no infection because the plant virus does not infect the patient. And our case, a mouse or a dog. So with all these immune cells there and all these immune cells really activated, like they're fired up, these immune cells now start taking care of the tumor cells. And as this process starts, this is a very complex cascade that eventually leads to not just innate immune cells, but also adaptive immune cells coming into the tumor bed, killing tumor cells, but not just locally, but rather systemically. So if this initial treatment works, what we have as a result is a treated tumor, but also systemic activation of the immune system, immune cells patrolling the body systemically, fighting metastatic disease, and also protecting from recurrence of the disease.
I understand that there are also potential applications for more effective pesticides. How would this approach minimize pesticide exposure?
Yes, so that's a very interesting area in my lab, the precision farming. It's a newer research direction, and I think a really fun aspect of our research. So when it comes to pesticide applications, the methods are actually not that different from the way we treat a cancer patient, in particular if we treat a cancer patient with a chemotherapy. Essentially, the drug is a toxic compound that is neither very specific nor is it targeted. For the cancer patient, we give as much drug as we can to kill as many cancer cells as possible without killing the patient. And the concepts for pesticide delivery in some ways are the same. We have a very toxic compound that's not very specific, it's not really targeted, and we apply as much as we can. Now, problems are, in particular, when treating nematodes, these are roundworms that are feeding on the roots of plants. The pesticide applied needs to travel deep into the soil in order to target these nematodes. But the drugs are very hydrophobic, and soil is a very sticky environment. So the drugs bind to soil particles and they get absorbed by the soil. So what we do at the moment is we apply a huge dose of these pesticides and then flush them down using water. But what that means is that 90% of the pesticides that we apply end up in groundwater. So to me, this is a delivery challenge. So what if we take a nanoscale material to package the drug and then target it more specifically to the site of action, and target them specifically to the nematodes? So we thought about plant viruses because some plant viruses are soil-borne. So that means soil is their home. And so we hypothesized that plant viruses, because they're made out of proteins, they would have a way to penetrate soil or to diffuse through soil more effectively than the free drug or other nanoparticles. And when we found this is indeed the case, we can explain this by the fact that a plant virus being made out of proteins, it has a Switzer ionic nature. So meaning it has a patchy surface, and this avoids it to stick to the soil particles. So it has better transport properties in soil, and therefore can bring the toxic cargo, the pesticide, deeper into the soil, targeting the roots of plants. So based on these data, we are now just beginning to formulate plant virus-based nanocarriers to deliver pesticides into soil.
So Nicole, based on your description there, it sounds like you're using a plant virus, which you might expect to actually infect a plant, instead to treat it. How does that work?
So yes, plant viruses are infectious towards plants, and we want to avoid plants getting infected by the treatment. So there's actually very simple ways to render these plant viruses non-infectious. And here we borrow the techniques that have been developed for vaccines, where we have attenuated or inactivated pathogens that are being used. So that's these techniques we now apply towards the plant virus to render it non-infectious towards plants. We can do this by chemical inactivation, by UV cross-linking, or we can also make VLPs, virus-like particles. So these are particles that don't contain a genome, and the genome is the information on the part of the plant virus that makes it infectious. So if we remove that altogether, then we have a non-infectious product, a virus-like particle.
So you're the founding director of the center that's called Nano Immunoengineering, or short Nano-IE. What's the mission of the center?
Yeah, so myself and Liafang Zhang, also a professor of nanoengineering here at UCSD, we are both the founding directors of the center. We have a group of 10 faculty from engineering, oncology, and immunology, and we have one common goal, and that is to reactivate and augment the ability of the human immune system to combat disease through nanoscale intervention. Or in other words, our center focuses on materials and technologies to activate, to program, and reinstate optimal immune function. And what is unique about us is that all the approaches and all the technologies and materials we're considering and developing are biology inspired or biology derived. And our central mission is really to restore normal function. So moving away from the thinking of generating toxic drugs that can kill tumor cells. We don't want to directly kill a tumor cell. We want to interface with the immune system and have the immune system recognize there's a tumor and fight it. And this goes beyond cancer immunotherapies. Our work opens avenues for treating and preventing diseases that arise spontaneously. So cancer is one example, but other examples and areas we focus on within the center are cardiovascular disease, as well as autoimmune diseases and allergies.
Well, that's really fascinating. You've mentioned a little bit some of the different technology or research areas where you're bringing together different areas of expertise. What are your thoughts about the importance of collaboration?
I think collaboration is extremely important. As scientists and engineers, we spend years and years in highly specialized training, whether that is molecular biology, chemistry, polymer engineering, medicine, nanotechnology. We have PhDs and MDs, but every scientist has a very unique portfolio of knowledge and skill set. Every scientist will approach questions from different perspectives. And therefore, if we join our forces, it enables us to break down barriers and move much faster and more efficient.
So looking back over the past 15 or 20 years of nanotechnology, what do you think have been some of the most significant advances that have been made by the community?
Nanotechnology spans so many fields. I think a lot about the medical applications. So within the medical field, I would say the most significant advances are probably the immunotherapies. To me, an immunotherapy, you can almost think about it as a drug-free drug, where the therapy is not set out to kill. So a chemotherapy is set out to kill a tumor cell. But with an immunotherapy, we can think of it as a drug-free drug, as this is a nanoscale pharmaceutical approach to interface with the immune system to restore normal function. And the nanoscale here is important because our body, our cells communicate via nanoscale signals. Cells communicate with each other by chemical signals. They interact with each other via proteins, and proteins are nanoscale objects. So nanotechnology gives us an opportunity here to build materials at the ideal size scale to interact and interface with the immune system.
So looking toward the future, do you see specific areas of national and international challenges that you feel nanotechnology will play a role in helping to solve?
Yeah, I think nanotechnology touches on so many different aspects, right? We go from human health to agriculture to next generation battery electrodes. And I think to me, the biggest impact will be integrating nanotechnology more closely with biology. So for better human health products, we need nanoscale materials not only engineered to function, but they need to adapt at the interface of biology. But if you think about a nanoparticle being injected into the body, over time, this material needs to interact with various environments, like different tissues, different cells. So we need a a particle that can adapt and respond to these different environments. When it comes to next generation materials, to me, the next exciting development is the living materials. So either where living matter is enhanced with synthetic parts, or approaches where we use living organisms, microbes, to produce materials. We already do this in the pharmaceutical industry, where we produce pharmaceutics with microbes. But I think the next generation of materials, we can think about plastics being made from a microbe. So we would have a sustainable way of manufacturing programmed biology at the interface with nanotechnology.
I know that we share a passion for communication and education and mentoring. I just wanted to maybe give you an opportunity to share some of your thoughts on the importance of science communication and also helping to support the researchers that are just getting started.
Yeah, maybe let me start out by quoting Mimi Zeiger, who said that if you cannot communicate your data, they do not exist. I often use this when I teach graduate students, undergraduate students in scientific writing, how to give a presentation, how to make an effective poster, and so on. But even beyond teaching our graduate and undergraduate students how to communicate data to their peers, it's even more important that we as researchers, as a community, communicate what we do to the general public and to younger students. So a few years ago, I started an initiative, a program that we called the Nano Man. And this is a collaboration between myself and musical Retro Forward musical writing team, Krista and Barry. And the three of us developed this concept of the Nano Man. The Nano Man is a teeny tiny superhero on a mission to fight tumors. And together we've put together a musical theater plays, as well as clips of video games, to reach out to a wider audience and to communicate that nanoscience, nanotechnology can be really fun. It can be like a video game where you can control a nanoparticle that encounters various biological barriers within the body and sort of highlight some of the challenges with nanomedicine, but also highlight some of the scientific advances that allow us to push the barriers and develop nanomedicines that eventually are effective. So with this program, what we seek to do is to reach out to the wider community and show that science and engineering can be really fun.
I just want to thank you again for taking the time to talk with us this afternoon. Do you have any closing thoughts that you would like to share with our listeners?
So we are focused on nanotechnology, but I probably want to close with the statement, don't underestimate the power of biology. We often train our engineering students to formulate and build solutions. But I think it's very important that we not lose sight of biology. In the medical sector, the fundamental understanding of healthy versus disease state is the key in restoring a healthy system. And then when it comes to next generation materials, if we can start integrating or re-engineer our nanomaterials by integrating synthetic biology and using microorganisms to make the next generation of materials, I think we will be able to unlock the full potential of nanotechnology.
Thank you for joining us today for Stories from the NNI. If you would like to learn more about nanotechnology, please visit nano.gov or email us at info@nnco.nano.gov. And check back here for more stories.